Catherine, for your. I'm honored from your introduction. I'm glad to be here. It's a real pleasure for me to be here with you. Thank you for coming. Catherine Marshall knows very well the story of Santa Cecilia. She could herself give an introduction of our history. And I remember one of my first participation in an international conference was in Accra, invited by Catherine Marshall. She was working at the World Bank at that time. So you got immediately appointed, dear Catherine, because it's difficult for us, since we have many things running in Sant'Egidio, to describe exactly what Sant'Egidio is. But if I have to do that, and I have to do that, well, Sant'Egidio is an international lay association. So it's a mix between an NGO and a faith-based organization and a Christian community. It's a difficult, the first task of a member of Sant'Egidio is to correctly describe Sant'Egidio. So now we, which is very difficult, believe me, and now what we are. We are a movement, a Christian community that is now spread in about 72 countries with more than 70,000 members all over the world. And it's a sort of brotherhood of communities. It means that we are based in the nations, in the countries where we are, by nationals. So Sant'Egidio in Burundi is made by Burundians, Sant'Egidio in Senegal is made by Senegalese, and in Washington as well, as Charlie can show you. And this tells you already why we have that wide range of initiatives, because we are people trying to live and to answer to the challenges of the modern world on a Christian on a Christian base. So every problem, war, refugees, poverty, it's a personal challenge to our life as a Christian community. So we try to answer as a wide web of communities, so personally with our own energies, as a community locally, but also internationally. So it is a shared spirituality that tries to become answer to the challenges of the world. In this sense, it tells you why we have many things going on in Sant'Egidio. Perhaps Sant'Egidio is well known for its work for peace, more than other aspects. And but the dynamic, the path is always the same. We discovered that war was not only at the 80s, we are talking about the 80s, we have 47 years of history, now we are approaching the 50th anniversary of Sant'Egidio. We discovered in the 80s, while Sant'Egidio was becoming spread all over the world, that the war was not only a strategic or political problem, but was a wound on our skin. Because we had communities in Mozambique, we had communities in the Great Lakes, we had communities. We were spread now. So war was a challenge to the life of the community itself. And so how we got involved? We got involved because of our work for the poor. Serving the poor means also bringing peace. It is impossible to help a poor country or a poor part of the population or a vulnerable social group if there is a conflict going on or a situation of tension. So we were asked at the beginning to work for peace in Mozambique, and we are now at the end of the 80s. At the end of the 80s. That was the first involvement of Sant'Egidio. Even if it's not well known, even if we were already involved in Middle East scenario, trying to rescue some Chaldeans refugees from the war going on in Iraq. So there has been attempt before the Mozambique, but that's not very well known. Mozambique is the first case. It's a mediation that was run by Sant'Egidio together with other institutions from A to Z. And it was a war that was forgotten by, well, not forgotten, but no one was trying to do something for the war. So Mozambique was the first attempt, took 27 months to strike a deal between the two parties, the Renamo and the Frelimo, and it was a successful beginning. That was also an encouragement for further mediation, because since then we got involved in other mediation, not only in Africa, but also in other scenarios like Asia or Latin America, Central America especially. So, you can see we are not a think tank, we are not a mediation NGO. There are many, they do a great job, but we are something different. We are a Christian living body, we would say. And for us, peace, as Cardinal Martini used to say, is the biggest of the messianic goods. is the most important thing from which other things comes. And so this is why we still have a unity, a board of mediators that runs peace initiatives. I'm currently, in my second life, I'm the head of the international relations, which means a lot of things, not only mediations, means also relations with countries, because along the way we developed a wide range of relations and official status with some countries. Just to tell you, Sant'Egidio has now some headquarters agreement with countries like the Orders of Malta, like the Red Cross, which is an interesting development. This is why. This is one of the reasons we don't say Sant'Egidio is an NGO. We are running. We try to also to advocate for our international humanitarian programs. Catherine already quoted something like the Bravo project, which is a birth registration program for especially African countries. We are running it in Burkina Faso, Mozambique, and Malawi. Burkina Faso, we started 3.5 million people registered, adults and children, both. There is the biggest effort in terms of spending, which is the Dream Project, which is a global health project focused on HIV, but now developing other range of operation and malnutrition, which is running 10 African countries with hundreds of thousands of people under treatment. The tree therapy, not prevention, is the tree therapy. It's the European US standard of therapy. And so being an international officer of Sant'Egidio means many things. And it has nothing to do with archaeology and history. Absolutely nothing. And my third life is my family. I have a good life. And coordinating also the some offices we have around the world, like the Washington one, Brussels, Paris, Amsterdam. But still, it's very difficult. Now, I think we have to focus on something. I cannot speak for hours. So maybe it's good for me to tell you where we are now operating for peace, and also some words about the humanitarian corridors, which is a recent initiative that was developed by Sant'Egidio together with the Valdensian Church of Italy and the Evangelical Federation. And so it's an ecumenical effort to welcome refugees, to tackle human trafficking, and to strengthen security. The three aspects are in one initiative, and especially it's directed towards the Syrian refugees that are overwhelming Lebanon, Turkey, and Jordan. So it's also a sign of counter-tenants, as you say. And about peace, we should mention, as you did already, Catherine, the Senegal issue. I just came back from Gambia, Senegal, Casamance region. Central African Republic, we had the chance to discuss with Mohammed the Central African subject, especially the Muslim community in Vienna, together with some organizations. And also the Burundi situation, I think we can say some words about it. But we are involved also in Mindanao, to tell you an overview. In Mindanao, in the MILF, Manila government, we are involved in Libya, for example, and we are trying to do also something in Syria, but this is more confidential. Well, about, I will start from, if you allow me, from the Central African Republic. We have been trying to accompany the transitional process immediately afterward the arrival of Seleka in Bangui, but we were on the spot since 2003 when President Patassé was under attack by the guerrilla led by Bozizé, the president to be Bozizé. So for about 10 years we keep on welcoming people from Central African Republic. And I mean the political elite diaspora that were scattered in Paris and in other cities, European cities or African cities. I mean head of the guerrillas from Birao region and from other northern part of the country or western part of the country, and members of the government, the regime of Bozizé. So we established a good web of relation, and when Seleka came, we were ready to do something. So immediately after the coup d'etat, delegation of Sant'Egidio went to meet Chotogia and Adam and the others, big guys of Basilica, in order to push them towards a national dialogue, to a reconciliation dialogue, which went on for all the duration of the regime. It means that Chotogia had to resign in January 2014. But we had delegation coming from them. We struck a Republican pact there, which was also acknowledged by the UN as a serious framework of reconciliation dialogue. This was the political part of our work for Central Africa. We have been working with the Muslim community, as Mohammed very well knows. We have been working with armed groups also. And especially in the latest period, let's say the end of 2014 up to now, we have been working with the presidential candidates for what it seems to be one of the few fair elections in the region, because we will see the other election in the Central African region. This seems to prove to be very, very an effective work. I mean, we have been gathering the biggest, the heavyweights of the political elite of Central African Republic in Rome, in Mbangi. We signed some agreements. We worked together on the respect of the opposition and the constitutional guarantees. And it seems, well, Dologele, number two, arrived second, was one of the signers of the agreement, and is a close friend of Sant'Egidio. So it seems to have some effects. And I'm very glad to tell you. More recently, last thing I must say about Central Africa is the work to improve security during the pontifical trip, let's say. It was also important because up to the last moment it was not sure if the Pope could make all the visit or part of it only, because Bangui was not secularized. And it is still not secularized because there are parts of the city which are under control of armed groups. So the 2 weeks before the arrival of Pope Francis, we worked with the armed groups together with the Gendarmeria to let them respect the situation, to explain them the real meaning of the visit of the Pope, which is not a political visit, it was a pastoral visit, pastoral one. So it helped a lot, I think. And the only part that was not surprised was the bimbo, the combatant part of it. So I'm not going into the topographical notion of Bangui, don't worry. That was an overall picture of the Central African Republic. About Casamance and Senegal, so you know, some of you are interested, a few ladies there. We have been mediating for the last 2 years and a half between the government of Senegal, especially President Macky Sall envoys, and the MFDC Salif Sadio branch, the biggest, let's say the more influential, so we think, if we have other. We have been the mediators. I mean, we have a clear mandate from the presidency, and we have a clear mandate from the guerrilla. And in the last 29 months, we have been obtaining something. First of all, a ceasefire that is still going on. So no one is shooting in Casamance region controlled by Salif Sadio. The release of some hostages from the guerrilla. They had some soldiers kidnapped, seven of them. And the signature of some protocols of agreement on humanitarian measures, on transitional justice, and on natural resources. We still have one step to clarify with the guerrilla and with the government, which is the juridical status of Casamance. Of course, they started the war in the 80s to obtain independence. They will probably never get independence, but there are some middle solutions to obtain them, and we will try to have a deal on this. I just came back from the bush where I met the head of the guerrilla, and at least we agreed on the need to jumpstart the process, because there has been some months of break, let's say. And this is about Senegal. But you can ask more if you want more details. About Burundi, we are really scared about the situation, also because we have a widespread community of Sant'Egidio there with hundreds of members. Sorry. We 300 members, and we have been part of the history of peace of the country. Since we were involved in the Arusha negotiation, we have been part of the reconciliation and disarmament group under the Mwalimu Nyerere mediation. Now, it means that we have contact in all places, to regime, the inner circle of Nkurunziza, Nkurunziza himself, but also the opposition, the opposition that joined the government, the Rwasa opposition, but also the others that were sort of backing the attempt of coup d'etat some months ago, a couple of months ago, more than that. We are scared about the situation. We think that there is an international effort, but the real problem, the problem number one for the situation is the isolation of Nkurunziza, because isolating him would be pushing him toward more extremist position. And the US Special Envoy is doing a great job, giving him opportunity to show goodwill. African Union is doing a lesser good job, let's say, because they try to send troops there. How do you send troops to a country that is giving troops to other countries? It's a bit of a difficult situation. Things that was refused in the last summit of African Union. But there is a great need, and we will try in the next weeks and months, of a confidential dialogue between the two, let's say, the two aspects. This is also things that we can do. Sometimes one of the most important tools of Sant'Egidio, since we were mentioning the methodology, is to provide confidential space and time outside of the international pressure, outside of the media, and sometimes even outside the official framework of mediation. I mean, there is a need for more confidential discussion, and we need to stress this point with you. And Rome is, of course, the city of the Pope, is the city, it's an international city, but is also sometimes outside some system of international pressure. It's a different city, it's not Paris, it's not Washington, and it's not London either. I think I already...
The humanitarian corridors.
Last thing. Well, we have been welcoming refugees in Europe, all the communities of European communities of Sant'Egidio for decades. The soup kitchen for migrants opened in Rome in 82. And we have a well-established system of free school of languages for migrants in Europe, all over Europe, with thousands of refugees. We even set up a movement of former refugees that now find their way in the countries that are helping other new refugees, the new waves of refugees. It's called People of Peace. Peace is a key word to understand Sant'Egidio, by the way. Now, the flux of migrants is increasing a lot because of the Syrian war, because of instability in Libya, and because some factions in Libya are using the refugees as blackmail to Italy and to other countries. Europe is answering in a not coordinated way. No, actually it's all versus all in the European Union. I think refugees crisis in Europe is threatening the real existence of the European community, because it's Italy versus France, Greece versus Hungary, France versus UK, and Germany versus everyone else. It's a threat. What we are doing is to give a signal in the opposite direction. It is possible to raise energy from the private sector, from the faith-based sector, to welcome refugees as a private sponsorship. So we almost forced the Italian government to open this humanitarian channel. We signed a memorandum with the Interior Ministry and the Foreign Affairs Ministry to have at least 1,000 visa per year. From now we're starting in Lebanon, but we want to multiply this experience in Morocco and Ethiopia. Of course, Morocco for the West African part refugees, and Ethiopia for the Eritrean refugees. Eritrea is a tiny country, but it's a high percentage of the refugees are coming from Eritrea, as you very well know. So, as I told you, it's a way to strengthen security, because these people, these refugees, are identified and checked in the country of living, not in Italy when they arrive. It's not in the emergency that we check them. It's in the refugee camp of the Bekaa North in Beirut. It's in Jordan that we recognize them, we identify them. We give them a territorial limit visa for Italy only, because if it was a Schengen visa, then it would be an enormous quarrel with other European countries. But this is another aspect of the situation. And it's an initiative that doesn't cost a penny to the Italian government, because it's the Waldensian Church, it's the Evangelical Church, and it's Sant'Egidio who is running this thing. Trip, accommodation, and everything. Even the process of recognition in UNHCR system. Doesn't cost a thing to the government, of course it's an expense for us, but it's amazing the response we got from the civil society. We are receiving proposal of welcoming families, children, adults, and elderly from everywhere in the country. That means that, of course, refugees are a threat. It's an important issue, but it's not only we want to protect our wealthy countries and we have to chase them away. There are people of goodwill that need to express their will to cooperate, and it's amazing the requests we're receiving to help them. We only have to find a channel to let them in, let's say. Who we are welcoming, because you could say you are welcoming Christians or Muslim or what kind of people we are welcoming. They are asking it every time. We're welcoming vulnerable people, sick person, elderly, disabled, mother with children alone, and there are a lot in refugee camps. So it's not an ethnic or confessional base, please. Yes, the first family arrived at the beginning of February. It was a family with three children. One of the young ladies, she's 8 years old. She had a cancer, she could not be treated at the height, here. An eye, and she lost an eye. So she had to come to be treated. But there was no way to force bureaucracy to let her in. So that was the first family. Yesterday, the first group of 100 arrived in the Ciampino airport, welcomed by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Italy and other authorities. That at the beginning, when they were completely scared about this process, because they were reasoning about, politically, it would mean a lot of votes less in the next election, because we are doing exactly what is scaring our constituents. Now they understood that you can raise positive energies on that, and they are riding the right horse, I think. That was the last initiative. Interesting, last thing, one of the People of Peace member, Said, is an Algerian, one of the worst member of one of the first guests and worst guests of the soup kitchen, problematic one, is now in Lebanon being a cultural mediator for those refugees camps. It's an example of how we work. Now it's time for you to make questions, because otherwise I speak too much.
Okay, I'm sure that we're going to have a lot of questions from the floor, but let me first ask you, first, you're in charge of the International Affairs Department. Roughly how many people within the community are involved in this mediation work? And we had a little discussion before we started. I interviewed Mario Giro, who was your predecessor and who has been involved from the very beginning. And one of his comments was that basically, well, he first of all, he puts a tremendous emphasis on the fact that you are not a professional mediating organization, and on patience and sort of the accident of friendship almost. But his comment was that there really isn't a methodology, whereas you reacted and said, of course there's a methodology. So if you could just tell us a little bit about how the system works, and then perhaps we can open it up.
Well, the structure is very, starting from the beginning, the structure is very light. In my office, we are five. Roughly about this, it's 12, from 12 to 15, maximum 20. It's a flexible group. There are people who are following a specific dossier, but not necessarily works 24 hours for the peace mediation unit. So it's a small group that is enlarged by other people that work less less intensity, let's say. But the structure, generally speaking, of Sant'Egidio is very light, because we are all volunteers, as you stressed already. That means that we are not professional in a strict sense, but we are not, at the same time, we were not born yesterday. I mean, there are some specific competences in Sant'Egidio and mediation. I am an archaeologist, it is true, but I quit digging tombs many years ago because I had to study other things right now. And so the group is small, we are doing many things, but we have to say that you cannot keep a dossier alive, pushing it to be alive. I mean, there are some sleeping dossiers that you have only to be at the window and wait for the good space to do things, to the opportunity to do things. Casa Maiz is clearly an example because I've been waiting for 20 years to have the opportunity to work there. Because either Diouf and Abdoulaye Wade, they didn't want us to do anything, so we did it. Just keeping the channel open. I mean, so we don't need 5 persons to follow the issue for 20 years. It's possible. But you were also mentioning the methodology. According to the Vice Minister, Mario Giro, there is no methodology. Well, he wrote something on methodology, so I do not agree, but it depends on what you mean with the methodology. If there is a manual, there is no manual in strategy. There is no theoretical directions to keep the mediation, because the first aspect of Sant'Egidio mediation, it's a spiritual one, it's a personal approach. Because we consider war as an illness for the soul. It's a choice that poisons the soul of men and entire people sometimes. And to heal this, of course, you need a good strategical ground, you need some leverage, even some international power. But first, since war is a personal choice, they decide to wage war. Also, peace must be a personal choice. You must be convinced. It cannot be only convenient for your movement or your group or your army or your guerrilla movement. This can be done with listening a lot, being patient, and also explaining who we really are. I mean, there is a credit Sant'Egidio can spend, which is quite unique. I'm not boosting anything, but we are people who serve the poor, believers. We have no interest whatsoever, even on the financial group, we are always on the red part of the bank account. So it's something that is clearly perceived, even by some very bad Korean movement. You come to Sant'Egidio when you are convinced to come, not because it's convenient or you need a spot to say what you want to say. Otherwise you don't come, or we don't invite you either. So I just say a few things, patience, who we are is a part of our methodology, this personal approach, also the fact that we are not a punitive subject, because according to Mario Giro, who wrote the methodology, a punitive subject has a difficulty in mediate. So there are other aspects.
One thing that I heard from some of my friends in Sant'Egidio is that the involvement of the communities is the basis, in many cases, for the invitation to be involved in the process. And that includes things like visiting in prisons, where you would meet some people who would later become combatants or who are connected with combatants. So that it is in that sense. But I guess now you also are sufficiently well known that you might be approached by groups where you have no real historical involvement.
Sometimes you have to say no.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's difficult for us to consider that we always walk on the
mission.
We always have a difficult path because sometimes we cannot involve our local members in the mediation because it means risking their life and the life of the community there. So that's why meetings are always be held in Rome. But the example of what you say is the current president of Guinea-Conakry. Alpha Condé was a person who used to visit and bring food to the prison during the regime of Lanzana Conté. So when he won the election, I said, oh, I know that guys, I know these guys. That's a Sant'Egidio, they brought me sandwiches. But that's part of the credit you spend because you work with the poor, in the good name of Sant'Egidio, let's say.
Okay, John.
Thank you.
And would you please just introduce yourselves?
I'm John Borelli. I'm in the office of the president. Thank you. Thank you, Mauro, for your presentation and your summary. What's the future for the Central African Republic, and do you intend to be involved with them for a very long time?
I start immediately. The future is the re-establishment of the country, not re-establishment, I correct myself immediately, the establishment of the authority of the state in all provinces, prefectures, because there has been part of the country which has never been under control of the Bangui government, like Birao, like some part of the Bouar provinces. This has been no man's land for decades. So to reestablish this will be the first step. And to do this, and this is also the part of the answer, to do this you need to strengthen the capability of Mr. Touadéra and his government to mediate with these people, to mediate with Miskin and the FDPC in Bouar, to mediate with some splinters of the Seleka group in Bambari. This is the line of engagement. Of course, the political dream they are living now, with people accepting electoral results, must be maintained, must be strengthened. This is on the political side. Of course, there is a huge work, community-based work, with the Muslim community and with other parts of the population that needs to be done. Sant'Egidio will be there as well. Also because there is a small growing community there that gives us a lot of information.
Yes.
Thank you so much for your talk and your good spirit too. I really feel that coming from you. My name is Ken Dante. I've worked as a counselor and a therapist with people that were very vulnerable, but also have worked with interfaith communities. And one of the things that I've noticed in either mental health communities or spiritual communities, both in communities that deal with mental health issues, but also spiritual communities, is there are a lot of internal tensions in the community. We often try to make a difference in the world, but the process in the community is not always very healthy. I was wondering what you do in your communities. Do you have a process or a model to resolve the inner tensions that happen within the community itself, recognizing that you are a spiritual community? Thank you.
That's a good question on the very nature of Sant'Egidio, you mean. Well, you always say if a house is divided in itself, it should fall. I mean, that's the real problem. We share the same spirituality, that is true. But there is a lot of freedom in how to answer the challenges of the world. So, in that sense, the unity of the communities all over the world as a place is in Rome. And is a president of Sant'Egidio is the guarantee of the unity among all the communities. Internally, in the everyday life, let's say that it's a matter of serving, responsibility, and leading a community means serving it. So the more you want to lead a community, the more you have to serve and to be available to all the needs of a specific Sant'Egidio community. The best guarantee for our unity is the poor people, living with them, spending time with them, and including them in our family. That's the best protection you have from division, from quarrels, and from spiritual difference. Though poor people are real our protectors, our saint protectors. And it's a sacrament if you want.
Yes. Well, thank you so much. My name is Mohammed Sanusi. I network of leaders and traditional peacemakers here in Washington, D.C. Thank you, Professor Marshall, for the invitation. Mauro, nice to see you again. And I really wanted to just congratulate Mauro and the work that he has done in Central African Republic. I was on the ground in Central African Republic in April of 2014, but actually, when I went there to difficult areas, PK5, when the majority of Muslim communities are there and was difficult even to go there, I found Mauro's reputation is already there. And he actually laid the ground for me to talk to Muslim community leadership and exactly addressing the issue of spirituality. He connected with the community to the extent that, you know, make them to be open for dialogue. And the reason I was there on the ground, because exactly to answer the question of how to answer and discuss the internal rift between the communities. So we noticed that there is a rift within the Muslim communities in Central African Republic, which actually negatively impacted the reconciliation and social cohesion in the country. And we worked with that. So the community was very touched on this, and we worked together, and actually I get Mauro's business card, copy of his business card from the mayor of the third district, which was a Muslim in the majority Muslim neighborhood. But the visit of Pope Francis to this difficult area also made a huge difference in the community, in the Muslim community in particular. And that's Mauro's work actually made the situation actually better, so the Pope could visit and sit with the chief imam of the central mosque and connect with them spiritually. You know, this is really very interesting, you know, when they are telling me these stories. Mauro and I were just coming from Vienna, where we convened Muslim community leaders from Central African Republic to basically, again, try to deal with their internal rifts. And coming back to the spirituality, behind door, we brought the imams that are basically not in the same kind of opinion, or they are fighting each other, with Sheikh bin Bayyah in the cross door. Again, Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayyah is a famous Muslim leader, so that we can again touch on that. As a result, they went back to the hotel and they had their own meetings. And they said, we have to unite among ourselves if we want the international communities to help us. So just for John, also just to follow up on Mauro's answer to this, the country, Central African Republic, is ready for reconciliation and social cohesion. And I completely agree with Mauro, we need to support the new government, Mr. Duarte, the new president, as well as we need to be practical in the way that the UNDP in Bangui told us, yes, you can bring peace, you can work in peace, but when people come back, they cannot be in peace. You need to have life with projects. You need to increase the inter-religious part, collaboration and partnership in service project that can touch this kind of areas. So I just want to make that comment.
May comment on your comment just one second. Part of the division, as you know, part of the division of the Muslim community of Central African Republic, we can turn around on spiritual values or way of teaching Islam, but the problem is that when Seleka arrived and was clearly connotated as a Muslim movement, guerrilla movement, a lot of people from the Muslim community celebrated their liberation. And this has not been forgiven. Some wiser Muslims said no. This is not the traditional way of a Central African man or a woman to live the Islamic faith. And this is the original sin, I would say, that was fueled also by the attitude of Bozizé, divide et impera, divide et impera. And now, from this point, they divided themselves, and there has been mistake in the path, but I think they will come out with a solution back to all our efforts.
Hi, my name is Kevin Sullivan. I'm with Georgetown's Initiative on Catholic Social Thought and Public Life. Thank you so much for your presentation. I was just in Rome 2 weeks ago and I visited Sant'Egidio's restaurant in Trastevere, which is served by those with physical and mental disabilities. It's beautiful food and restaurant. Thank you. I also just
not
want to comment.
Expensive.
No.
No, very reasonable. Very good promotion in Trastevere. I want to say I was fascinated by your story of Sant'Egidio's success in the refugee resettlement issue in Italy, obviously Europe, and in the United States. Obviously, this is a big issue right now. Catholic Charities being one of the largest organizations in administering refugee resettlement under government grants. But obviously, there are many Catholics who also are on differing sides of this issue, and something our initiative attempts to discuss. Do you have any advice or lessons learned from that experience on how Catholic Charities and other organizations working on actually working with these refugees and bringing them into communities and serving them? How do we discuss that, share that with others, so that we could perhaps have a similar impact on government, others, and communities?
It's interesting what you ask, because it's a debate going on within the Catholic Church of Italy and other European countries. And I would quote some example. The Pope, on many occasions, said the church, parishes, congregations, religious institutions should open their door and welcome people, because seminars are empty, monasteries are empty. What do we do in this space? Welcome. It's the gospel, it's Jesus. We must do that. Well, the reaction was not exactly okay. The Pope said, we do. We've been not that Catholic in this sense. But there has been efforts. We must do more. But when a church or a faith-based organization open itself to welcome refugees, it immediately gives good energies and strengthening. The example being the Catholic Church of Austria, for example, which is an extinction church. It's going down and down and down. The fact that they were on the front line to welcome refugees coming from Hungary, from the Balkans, the cardinal said, of Vienna, said, oh, the churches are full again. What happens? What happens? You are following the gospel. And then began being too religious, but it's a debate, and I think it's very clear in the United States when the quarrel between the Pope and Donald Trump, no? It was the first page of all the news in the world. But building a wall is not Christian. It's not Catholic, but the wall is not Christian. And the fact that it's an ecumenical effort, the one we are doing, it's also a good sign. But I'm talking as a Europe, as a European man. What we are protecting? Our wealth, our rich countries. But we are growing old. Italy, Hungary, they are growing old. The average is 65 years old. If we don't welcome other people, we will disappear in a luxury way, I would say. I don't see the need to protect. Of course, we have to discuss how to include them, how to integrate, how to deal with other religions. But this is a secondary problem. The problem, you cannot stop them. You can build a wall, 2,000 kilometers or miles, I don't know, along the border of Mexico, but you won't stop them. And if you talk to young people in Guatemala or in El Salvador, you would know you cannot stop them. Because it's better to jump on a train than to live under the marks. That's it.
Crystal, and then Dennis.
Yes, my name is Crystal Corman. I work here at the World Faiths Development Dialogue. Thank you so much for your talk, for the points, and for all of the questions that we've had around the table. So I'll just add a new question other than giving some of the other nuance now. I come from a background in peace studies, and in that field, we often look at people that are doing the mediation and the negotiation, and noticing that there are very few women that are in those roles. And so I wondered, after listening to you describe the community of Sant'Egidio and the way that you're involved and invited to mediate some of these spaces, are you Are you then a community that is able to maybe lift up women in that way? Do you have more women that are participating in those roles? Or if that is not the case, then when you are in those environments and the work that you're experiencing that you've done, how have you made sure that women are involved, included, not only in being protected, and but also thinking about their agency and their voices being heard in the process?
Women are involved. In our staff, we are 40, 60, maybe 35, 65, 65 being males, and are included in the delegations that are coming, always, especially in recent years, even from unsuspected countries like Mali or Brazil, it's about gender representativity. When it comes to sending women in some parts, well, it must be more prudent there, because not only to protect them, but also to have impacts. If you talk to a traditional leader somewhere, it doesn't necessarily mean for women. But it's not that we don't want to send; it's that we have to be effective. But it is changing very rapidly, I must say. It's changing very rapidly, and even in some very archaic societies, becoming more and more influential to have delegates that represent the women, and also to list to counterbalance this. Central Africa, one of the best friend and best supporter and mediator of Sant'Egidio, is Madam Koye Sundunta, the Vice President of the Parliament. She's been attending all the meetings of Sant'Egidio, and she's one of the lady who push the solutions. So without her, we would have done half of the job. So it is there, we have to improve.
My name is Dennis Kapala. I also work out of the president's office. One of the things I do is the liaison with the Sant'Egidio. Another is with meditation. I like to put those two things together. I wanted to just make a comment on your question, and then ask you a question. The comment that I have about bringing refugees together of all different faiths and finding a common ground, that's something we do in meditation. We teach meditation to the refugee center over at near Catholic University. We have Catholic Charities has organized in D.C. And we teach it to the people who run the center there, and then they teach it to the refugees. The wonderful thing about meditation is that you can, it's a religious practice. It doesn't have to be a religious practice. It's something you can do together. If you're in silence and stillness, it doesn't matter what religion, what confession you are. So it tends to form a very good bond. And so that's one of the things that I'm hoping to work with now also with Sant'Egidio. My question is about the families that welcome, or the people that welcome the refugees in Italy, who you're hoping to get to host the families. How do you go about finding them? And are there many that you can find somehow finance among the poor, or do they all have to be wealthy enough to support the refugees coming to their homes?
No, it's mostly it's middle class, so, or families without children, or that grew without children, or the children grew up and they left the house, so they have space and energies and money to put on the basket, let's say. We are not looking for them, actually. They are coming to us now. So you have to know that the first family that arrived was a really emotional issue in the media. It was the first page of the Corriere della Sera, which is the biggest newspaper in Italy, put the face of this poor young lady with an eye. So you see, seeing the faces of the real face of person with difficulties, it changes a lot. Like Aylan Kurdi, the young boy who drowned on the coast of Turkey. It changed a lot. So they are proposing us to welcome. The problem is to fight the bureaucracy.
because if you have to see the mental state of everyone, you have to, it's like an adoption. You have to go through a lot of bureaucracy problems. And also, their status when they come to Rome or to Italy, it's an issue also, because they cannot move from Italy, because you give them a territorial limited visa. And if they move to other countries, well, maybe there is a Syrian or an Assyriac community that is willing to. Then you fight with the German authorities or the Austrian authorities or the French authorities. Look at what's happening in Calais, on the coastline in France. The problem is that there are unsuspectable energies to welcome them, and we have to give them the opportunity to do things. So we are not looking for them, they are coming to us.
Any last questions? Yes.
Yeah. Just take up of the situation in Calais, which I wanted to bring. How do you force the people?
Could you introduce yourself?
Hélène Bossinger-Chasseau, and I'm from Switzerland, from a teacher here. And I just am very concerned about the situation in France in particular, but all the countries who are becoming more and more secular. So you have less of a basis of Catholic institutions to support them. A lot of people, places like Italy, probably still have a lot of monasteries or former high schools, and it's the case in my country of Switzerland. They liberated a few high schools that used to belong to sisters, but those are not very numerous. And then in France, they have already gotten rid of most of the places they had.
Laïcité.
And what is going to take place in a secular society that is already riddled with unemployment and social problems, and then has suffered this enormous attack in November 13th. So they are even less driven to, welcome refugees. And what can we do about the situation in those countries who are not readily welcoming them? And any experience you have? Helpful.
Well, I'm not a sociologist, so I cannot draw the line between the secularization and the lack of hospitality in European countries. For sure there has been, in many European countries, a lot of hysterical reaction. Look at Calais, as we mentioned, but look also at the law against minarets in Switzerland, to mention your country, and also at the propaganda of the Liga Nord in Italy. There are always people who try to use the fears of people to get electoral or political advantages or benefits. Still, I don't know. I really don't know how to answer. What I noticed, not only in Italy, is that welcoming is a way to recover the spirituality, to recover the will to be part of a community, faith-based or not faith-based. We put in circle many energies and many contacts. You break your isolation, basically. I saw this when we proposed, our community in France proposed to have a caravan from Paris to Calais to go and help migrants. We received an unexpected support from many peoples. And the same goes in Hungary. In Hungary, we have a community that is really, really small in Budapest. It's a newborn community, it's 50, 60 persons. Well, we have a small church in the center, and we decided, okay, now we are facing the emergency, let's change this church into a resting place for migrants. And we welcomed 120 migrants. We top first page on all the newspaper in Hungary. We received the prize, the cardinal came to serve them together. The more you open, you put everything in circle. But I know it's not a social kind of answer.
Any last questions? I have one more. Yes.
Hello, my name is Semih Hatopol. I am from Turkey and I'm a sociologist. of religion there. So my question is about the religious identity of your community, which is very open. And then when you reach out to especially conservative Muslim communities who are in danger or who are in need of urgent help, do you see or encounter any challenge or cultural backlash or fear of people of like missionary activities is held to be something as a national threat by some of these communities and countries? It doesn't have to be a religious concern, it can be a national concern too. So I want to hear about your experience in reaching out to these communities. I would say maybe difficult communities. And how do you deal with these challenges through the ways of interfaith and religious dialogue discourse? Thank you.
It's, you know, the answer would deserve 1 hour, but because I should go back in 35 years of history of relations and friendship between us and the Muslim world. Generally speaking, from the Malikid in Morocco to the Mohammedia in Indonesia, passing through Al-Azhar and many other religious institutions, Muslim religious institutions. I think you touch here a peculiar point of Sant'Egidio, the friendship with Muslim. And the efforts to understand the complexity of the Muslim world is one of our characteristics. We have a section that studies, that visit, that speaks Arabic, by the way. This is why, along the year, many mediations and initiatives of Sant'Egidio took place in Muslim-majority countries, like Niger, like Mali, like, of course, Egypt. Our founder, Professor Ricardi, gave a public lesson and a speech in Al-Azhar. I mean, but even the more you mentioned the more radical groups, I don't know if you mentioned the Ikhwan Muslimia or all other kinds. We talk to everyone. We talk to everyone because it's our vocation. We talk to everyone and we try to understand everyone. About the black lash and welcoming them, I think that genuine and friendly hospitality is the first step to heal any division. If I welcome a person coming from, let's say, I don't know, mention a Muslim country, Egypt, and I will welcome him as I can do, as a believer myself, then he will be the first ambassador of Sant'Egidio in the future. Just to give you an example, we got in touch with some Libyan movements because we welcome their relatives and parents in the soup kitchen and in the other ways in the world. So it's, no, I see many difficulties, but not one single difficulty that can not be overcome through friendship and that. That's for sure.
Okay, let's just have one last question. You've alluded to the link between peace and development and hope and future prospects, but I think the practical links between these worlds are very weak. And I'm interested in the situations where you're working in the Central African Republic. Is there somebody seriously working on trying to come up with a vision of a path to the future? What about some of the other situations? What have you seen as positive examples and maybe areas which are less positive on building these bridges?
Between development and mediation. One of the complaints on the international communities on Central African Republic, of course, sexual abuse, many awful things, but also is the lack of a plan of development for the country. Because when we talk about development in Central African Republic, but in other countries as well, it's first natural resources. Wood, forest, but also oil, uranium, etc., etc. And this is part of the political debate, so this is part also of the mediation. Sharing these things, these wealthy things, is still it's very problematic. And you will see, I agree with you, that the relations are very tiny and weak. And we should do more about that. Because we see in a certain period of national reconciliation, of political debate, a lot of promises. When it comes to a new regime, a new development way, it fade away very soon. And it's the usual way, multinational companies, some former colonial powers, and bribing political leaders. Then there is a new regime, I will clear the corruption, and then it starts again. Medina should do more about that, you're right.
Well, I think we could go on all afternoon, but we have to liberate Mauro. So thank you very much to all of you for coming. This was a great discussion. It will be up on the website at some point, hopefully soon, so you can watch it again or tell your friends. And thank you so much for coming and welcoming you to the Berkeley Center. And I hope you'll come back again.
Thank you so much.